Welcome back from the break. It's Sports Fire with me and Ernest Koranteng. Successful soccer career abroad was the missing link. Tonight, we discuss that on Sports Fire. Big on your views. Keep your thoughts coming through by text and by mail. First of all, our social media platforms, facebook.com/metrosport, or the Twitter account is at metrosportstv, or send us a text on 050-940-0844, and you can call us later on the show when we make known the phone number. We're talking the activities of unscrupulous agents as part of the main discussion tonight on Sportfire. We're looking at it from three major areas: the role of the player, the clubs they transfer from, and the role of the agents or the agency. Tonight I've got in the studio a licensed agent who is based in England, who joined me for the conversation. Eby, thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much.
Good to see you. Eby Emenike is a licensed football agent based in the United Kingdom. So where exactly are you based?
I'm kind of based all over. At the moment, I'm based in London.
In London?
Yeah.
Okay. So I was going to ask if you are from Innit.
Yeah. Well, I'm not from Innit, but I live in it.
It reminds me of a joke about a man who says, "Oh, are you from Innit? Because anywhere I go, I hear you say Innit. Are you from Innuendo?"
No, we don't say Innit. I'm from Leeds.
You are from Leeds.
Yeah, so okay. We don't say Innit, but I live in London.
Okay, good to see you. So you've been working with some Ghanaian players. How many have you transferred so far abroad?
Well, I was involved in the transfer of one player, of Gideon Barr.
Okay, Gideon Barr.
Yeah.
You mean our own Gideon Barr?
Your own Gideon Barr.
Metro TV's Gideon Barr.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's credit to the MTN Soccer Academy that is.
It sure is, yes.
Season 8, and possibly the third edition of the Schools Challenge returns in September this year. I'm sure there are those who are looking forward to it already. Maybe hoping to unearth some more Gideon Barr. Yeah, we're talking about Gideon.
Yes. No, I was just saying I was involved in his transfer. You know, he was playing at Kotoko, mm-hmm. and then an agent in, because, you know, agents, we all work as a network.
Okay.
An agent in Europe, he actually worked in the UK, found a club for him and said, you know, I have a club that's interested in a left back. And we worked together and had Gideon transferred.
So he's in Finland now?
He is, yes.
Okay. How well is he doing? Good?
He's doing well, yeah.
Okay. So how many more on the way to Europe? From Ghana, from your stable?
From me? Mm. Well, at the moment, you know, it's very difficult. It's not
okay,
actually easy.
Okay, we're going to get into the challenges.
Technicalities, yeah, of actually transferring them over. Mm. I'm not working exclusively with any other Ghanaian players at the moment. Not exclusively.
Okay. Not exclusively.
I'm working non-exclusively.
Non-exclusively.
So I have, yeah.
But I'm sure you're looking at some. Ketty, some of your partners and all your...
Yep,
you're in Ghana, for instance. Maybe it's one of the things you may discuss briefly before you go.
Yes, I may discuss. I mean, I've been moving a little bit slightly away from player management.
Okay.
I'm not going away from it totally, but I've been moving slightly away because there are other things in football that have kind of taken my interest and where I believe I can give a little bit more.
But player management is where the cash is, isn't it? That's a perception. That's what we know.
Not in Africa.
Not in Africa.
Not in Africa. You get a lot of people who believe that, but it's tough in Africa. You know, I mean, I'm a strong woman, so I can cope with it. But it's very tough, and you get a lot of people who see you as charity, and, you know, you get a lot of disloyalty. You know,
From the players, from the clubs?
Just from people in general, from the players, you know, from the clubs as well. You know, there are people who would, you know, latch onto you when they need you, when they need something. But then as soon as they feel like they're at a place where they don't need you anymore,
that's it.
Then that's it.
They discard you. Do we have talents in this country? Young talents?
Of course.
Genuine young talent.
Yes.
We do.
Yes.
And you have not found any apart from Gideon Barr? You're not searching or you're not interested?
I'm not currently searching. I constantly get people, even like when I came into Ghana, you know, I put on Facebook that I was here, and straight away I already had people, you know, like some scouts and
call you regularly,
sending me messages. I mean, I always get players, you know, calling me up and, you know, saying that, you know, I know somebody. Even if I'm not interested in them, they tell me there's one of their friends who's really good, who was called for the under 17s, or, you know. So, I mean, actually finding players is not a big problem, to be honest.
It's not a problem.
It's not a problem. Actually transferring them out, that's where the big problem
comes. We'll get into that. Let's talk about the clubs.
Okay.
Transferring Gideon from here to Finland, you dealt with Asante Kotoko.
Yes.
Any other club, you dealt with other clubs, and how did the dealings go? How was the discussion? How was the operations in general?
How were the discussions? When I dealt with Kotoko, everything went quite smoothly. It was with Dr. KK Sapong. That was when he was there. One of the major problems we had was there was some difficulty in what the club were asking for and what the club were willing to pay, the buying club were willing to pay. Kotoko were asking for a certain amount and the club were saying, they didn't have that
Kotoko
amount.
Asked for a certain amount because of how well they developed the player. Explanation?
Yeah, well, it's probably how well they've developed the player. And also, I think each club will have, they'll have like certain grades of players and they know what they charge for each, what fee they would charge for, certain players. So if the player has played for the national team or if the player has played for the under 17s, under 20s, then all of a sudden you've had that European, you've had some exposure, some international exposure, shall I say. So, your price goes a little bit higher.
Okay. But if you talk about how well players develop, uh-huh. And let's take Gideon Barr, for instance. I'm sure there are other clubs involved in his development, not
yes.
just Asante Kotoko. There's something you call, is it compensation? Is it on?
Yes, you have the solidarity compensation.
Solidarity.
Yeah.
So it means there are other clubs that will be involved. Parent clubs, junior clubs.
Colts clubs, training clubs.
Colts clubs. Uh-huh. Did you face any difficulty at all dealing with all these clubs, or you've not gotten to the level, or you didn't get to the level where you needed to deal with these clubs?
I didn't have any problems dealing with the clubs when the transfer took place.
Okay.
But then after the player was transferred, I had some of his previous clubs contact me. And
okay.
they wanted to find out how much the transfer fee was and how much solidarity compensation they were due.
Have they received their solidarity compensation?
No.
No?
No.
Why?
Why? It's a little bit complicated.
Okay.
As is everything.
You don't have to exactly explain everything because
yeah.
it may take a lot of time. But
yeah.
why? I mean, if the club was involved in developing the player to mm-hmm. a certain level,
yeah.
then the club, obviously, according to FIFA, is expected
yeah.
to receive something.
Oh, according to FIFA, according to me as well. I mean, if I was there, I'd keep that rule because I believe that if there's a club that was involved in the player's development and the player's now doing very well, why shouldn't they, have a slice of the cake? Mm. But the system is a little bit corrupt.
System is a little bit corrupt.
Yeah, mm. and people don't always get what they deserve.
Really?
But that's one of the things I'm working on, and I'm trying to do my best to help some of the smaller clubs. When I said I'm moving a little bit away from player management and moving into other things where I think my time might be better used. It's one of the things I was talking about.
Often, where the player will finally move from to that dream club in Europe. There are issues of, okay, how well did this club develop the player? Because often the players will come from a lower division team or a Colts club or something. There are issues about how some of these clubs will force the players out. And also how these clubs will cut deals, as it were, for the players without necessarily looking out for their interest. Are you aware of these challenges and how do you deal with them as an agent?
Oh, yes. I mean, it's difficult. It's very, very difficult. And that's one of the advantages of having an agent. I mean, in everything, there are pros and cons, some people might say that one of the, I think for players, one of the cons is the fact that they have to give some of the, the commission when the agent's working for them. But, one of the big pros is that you have somebody who's there for you, who you can trust, and who is on your side. So at the end of the day, I think it's important that the agent is there to actually look out for the player, and when it comes to clubs trying to cut deals with other clubs for the player, the agent is there to basically say, no, I don't think this is the right move for the player, and I think that the player should take a different move. But I understand exactly what you're saying because it does happen.
Okay.
It does happen. I've seen it.
We've been speaking to some club administrators. James Oedeji is a club official of Mighty Jets. Mighty Jets played in the Premier League only two seasons ago. So they are playing in first division now. They are playing lower division football. James has been talking about these issues, how clubs sometimes will force these players to go out because, listen, they've got to pay their bills. The only way they can make money is to sell these players. So it's difficult looking out for their interests. Money won't come from gates. Money won't come from merchandising or sponsorship. So you've got to sell the players. James believes it is a big challenge that's got to be dealt with if we're to find better careers for these players abroad.
It's immediately we move from the traditional club ownership, whereby everybody contributes a little. Everybody contributes. You don't see any one man showing his face that I'm a large grocer, sole owner, apart from Kazim. Sole owner, apart from Kazim. Nobody takes decision in Kinfesa. If you go to a chairman, chairman's exit, see what how it has affected Chelsea. Abu Sundoku, a little shift in his finances, see how it has affected to do mighty Jesse. A Liberty professional, Slateta has passed on to the great beyond. See what is happening to Liberty. So the individual ownership warrants you getting more money by selling half-baked players. The players that left those days, especially under Steven Kershaw regime, where Steven Kershaw took the best of the creme de la creme of the young boys under 22 in West Africa. Odate Lamte, Sheya Adebayo, Olu Otubumusi, you know all those boys who went to Europe, they did very well. So now, you also shift the blame again to the European clubs who are now ready to buy half-baked players instead of the traditional high-quality players like Abedi Pele, Giorgio Ponwia, Rashid Yekini, Emmanuel Amunike and co. So the problem is both sides. And it is because of the global interdependence of economy. Because now we have to, there's a shift of resources from developing countries to the developed countries. And then what they do is that they add a little value and they start trading the player among themselves. Take Prince Tego. What did Prince Tego achieve? When Prince Tego was playing as an attacker and a white man saw him, he wanted to convert him to a central defender because of his height and his liberal stature. He refused because the folk are more interested in selling him to get that 1 million than to keep him for another 1 year. The biological mothers put pressure on the club owners and the club coaches to sell my player. Why are you keeping my player for more than 2 years? Let him go. Eric Beckwin, example. Solomon Asante, example. At the end of the day, even the Exodus is not crossing the Atlantic. It is going eastwards towards Congo, TP Mozambique. What is the difference between TP Mozambique and Kumasi Asante Kotoko? Because of lack of finance.
Oh, James Oyedeji, man, on point, man. You know, but he's raised some pertinent issues there.
Okay.
Is there any truth at all that maybe clubs are under pressure to let the players go because they've got to generate revenue to run the club? That is one. And there's incessant pressure from family members of these clubs. And he gave some very good examples. Mm-hmm. Like Eric Beckwin, for instance, at some point, his mother was regularly having meetings with Asante Kotoko. Let my boy go abroad because that's where he can make a lot more money. Are you aware of these things? Are these things real at all?
Yeah, oh, I'm aware of them. I'm aware of them, and they are very real. Mm. But I don't believe that clubs are selling half-baked players. Because I think if the clubs in Europe or wherever are willing to buy the player, then why not? You know, if they want a half-baked player, I mean, they obviously don't see the player as half-baked.
Okay.
That's the way I see it. Otherwise, they won't take it. And, you know, if they, you know, want to take a half-baked player and think that player is going to do well in their team, then why not? I mean, one of my issues with clubs selling players is when they're selling players for financial gain of the club, it's difficult because, I mean, a club needs to make money. Mm. At the same time, a player needs to build his career. Okay. So it's a balance you have to find.
But do clubs look out for this balance? Do they care about this balance at all?
No, probably not.
It's often how much we're getting.
Exactly. And that's what I'm saying. That's why it's good for the player to have an agent who can put their foot down and say, no, I don't think this player should go there. You know. But a lot of times it's player desperation as well. You know, the player just wants to go. I've had players tell me to take them to Sudan, you know, take me to, you know, Iraq. They just want to
Iraq.
Leave. They just want to leave their home country. You know, and they believe the grass is greener somewhere else until they go and come back, which, you know, I've seen that as well. They've gone and come back and said, Madame, what you told me is true, you know, but yeah, I mean, you know, at the end of the day, it's like, say, you know, you've got a young player who is not very experienced, say Man United want to buy him, say a small club, you know, in the first division in France, say wants to buy him, the chances are Man United are going to be able to give more money. Okay. So the club selling will be more interested in selling him to Man United because they'll get more money. But that player is going to go to Man United and sit on the bench because they won't be able to keep up.
When ideally he should go to that smaller club and develop more.
Exactly. When Gideon went to Finland, I remember the criticism. Why is he going there? It's a crap league. You know, they're not very big. But he went there and he played every single game, apart from a couple of games when he was on suspension. And, you know, he ended up winning the Defender of the Season. He won Rookie of the Year. And, you know, he's now moved on to a bigger club. And you don't know where that's gonna lead him. Whereas there are some players who have gone to some of these big clubs and they've sat on the bench for 3 years, you know?
Okay, so we're having a major conversation about the successful careers of players abroad, players who live here and go to play abroad, and what the missing links actually are. We've heard from James Oedeji, who is a club official with Mighty Jets, speak to us about the demands by the clubs. So that covers the role of the clubs. The clubs often must sell. Sometimes they have to sell the rookie players. Sometimes they have to sell the half big players, as he described it, because they've got to generate some revenue for the clubs to run. And the pressure from family members as well. We've seen examples in this country. So, I mean, that point has been well dealt with. Keep your thoughts coming through by text and by mail. Check out our social media platforms, facebook.com/metrosports. Twitter is @metrosportstv. Send us a text on 050-940-0844 and we'll activate the phone lines for you to speak to us. Let's get into other things. Before we talk about agency and the role of the agent, let's talk about the players themselves. Okay. I asked you earlier if we've got talents in this country. Uh-huh. Often, yeah, you may have transferred only one player and maybe you're looking forward to working with others or transferring others. Uh-huh. But generally, because of your work as a certified agent, uh-huh, what's the level of quality of the ordinary Ghanaian player who has the chance to travel abroad, say at 17 or 18 years? Are they indeed half-baked? What amount of work must be done on them by European clubs before they become the stars we look forward to them becoming?
Well, I mean, you know, those kind of things kind of speak for themselves. Mm. If you look at the players that have been transferred at that age, you know, how many of them are actually playing first team football? You know, that in itself should be able to answer your question. I believe there is a lot of talent, but you could have the best player in the Ghanaian league go to a European league and struggle.
Why?
Because the level of football is totally different.
Okay. So ideally, what would he have to do? Because he's the best in Ghana. He's the top scorer in Ghana. Mm-hmm. So if he goes abroad, he should play.
He should. Well, it'll just be a case of experience. He'll need to train. I remember when Gideon was in Finland, he said that, you know, he'd learnt so much in the few months he was there. The technique, you know, in which they play is different. You know, I suppose the technical experience that the coaches give you is totally different. It's totally different. You know, the game's a little bit faster. It's different. It's different.
So, would it be right for anybody to say that Ghanaian player who was top scorer in the league last season who went to Europe and couldn't play, mm-hmm, when they as a half big player? I mean, would it be fair for us to make that judgment? Because he won the best player in this country, went abroad and couldn't play, maybe he could not cope with the situation, could not adjust and all. So do you refer to such a talent as a half-baked
player? No, I wouldn't say they're half-baked, because if they're doing the best they can with the best that they have in this country, then there's not really much more that they can do. They're top here. So when they go to Europe, it's just a case of being given that experience and being given that opportunity. Unfortunately, when you go over, you might not get that much of a chance, mm-hmm, because football is business, like we've already talked about. People want to win, you know, cups. People want to make money, you know. So if they buy a player and they're playing you and you're not scoring, you know, after a few games, you might get benched. And at that time when you get benched, you might not get an opportunity again to play until maybe there's an injury or something, you know, drastic happens to, you know, whoever you're taking their position.
But it is so difficult for an African player to live here, whether as a top star or as somebody who is extremely talented, to go into Europe and do well, maybe after a season or two. Is it a challenge with the perception that Europeans have about us? That maybe you're just not good enough, and you have to go through so much by way of training to be able to play at the top level. So they are allowing their prejudices to work against the African players, or we're simply not good enough to go there and get straight into the league and do well. What's the situation?
No, I don't think it's anything to be. I don't think it's not being good enough. Mm. It's just having the experience and the kind of training that you have here compared to. I mean, you can't compare the training at say Kotoko to the training at say Chelsea. Mm. You know, in the UK. Not okay. I forget you have a Chelsea here. Yeah. You know, the Chelsea in the UK. You can't compare the types of training that they've had. So there's
but
no.
But is it wholly different? Are the methodologies not just about the same? Are they not similar? Do you not get onto the pitch and stretch and maybe do the running and get somebody to speak to you? And I mean, do you have to reinvent everything? Are there not similarities so that when you move from here to Europe, you just need an upgrade?
There will be similarities. I mean, you know, one of the reasons why, you know, I'm trying to work with clubs in Africa mm. and bring partnerships from clubs in Europe and clubs in Africa.
Like you've done with Asante Kotoko and
Sunderland. Yeah. Exactly. Mm. So stuff like that, you know, you can, Kotoko can learn from Sunderland, you know, some of these techniques. Because when we went to Sunderland and went on the tour, we saw some of the training equipment that, you know, really had everybody's mouths open, you know, because okay. nobody had seen that kind of equipment before, you know, and they were telling us how they're used and what they use them for. You know, they have teams of, you know, psychologists and, you know, and physiotherapists, and these are, you know, highly qualified and trained people.
You know what I think about all these things? Okay, maybe they invented the game. So they would always want to make it their own. They would always want to, but it doesn't take away our talent, really.
No, we have raw talent.
There's
raw talent here, and I haven't spoken to anybody who doesn't like African players. Okay. African players are strong. You know, they always say African players are really strong and they're determined, you know, and they give it their all, especially the ones that have just come over. Mm. You know, they'll die for getting constant playing time.
Okay. Benjamin sent us a message. He says, when our players hit top form on the local front, they have no time to make considerations as to which league will suit their style. So when they go there, they easily fade out when they make wrong choices. Albert says, our players often play cheap teams because at least they are better off than playing in Ghana. Fred Appiah says, the local league is not producing the quality to match up the standards abroad. Our players are focused on money rather than equipping themselves for the challenges overseas. One person who's been talking about player exodus and whether the players are half-baked or fully baked, I don't know. It's Neo Datilamte, who also led the shores of this country very early. Remember that project by the boss, Stephen Keshi? So Odatilamte is one who benefited from that and left this country very early to play football abroad. He's been talking about the role of players in ensuring that they get successful careers abroad.
You see, now everybody wants to leave. And I'm not blaming them, to be honest with you. Whereby our league is a bit dodgy, we are not paying the boys well. So when anybody come and he said, maybe, excuse me to mention this, can maybe India or Bangladesh, I want to pay you $1,000 a month, he will go because he's not earning that one here. So you see, they are also rushing, they want future for themselves, for their family. And that's why we are having all these kind of problems. Our boys are going to take their time. You know, sometimes people like us, when I'm going to talk to them, they will take it in a different way. You know, it's two way. One, they will think maybe I don't want them to go, or two, I'm being a bit jealous, you know. But then if they will listen to advice for some of us, maybe Abedi Pele, Tony Eboa, and other ex-footballers, I'm sure they will take their time, and at the right time, you move. Because now things have totally changed in Europe. I can tell you, before even a team will sign you, there's somebody there who wants a share before you've been signed. If you don't give him, you go, and then there will be a problem. So all these things are there. You know, and now that's why FIFA has brought these rules that without FIFA license, as an agent, you can't transfer a player. So sometimes most of them do hide, you know, behind those who have license and then be doing all this dodgy thing. Yeah, some will take you there after taking his money, and that's it. You won't see him again. And it's also bad, you see. So we have to be very careful. That's why I'm saying that they need some of us to advise them. Me now, if I see a dodgy agent, I will know, because he's taking you there, take his money, and then he forgot about you. Whatever you eat, what you drink, he doesn't care.
Neo Datilante, the best ever juvenile player the world has seen. Okay, so speaking to sports fans out there. So, is there a genuine rush to play abroad by players? You say you get the calls all the time.
Oh, yes.
You get the emails. They call you.
Yes, oh yes.
There's a rush to go out.
Yes, oh yes, oh yes. There's,
and they say what? It's economics.
The
league is not good.
Well,
they're paid well.
Well, a lot of them tell me that, you know, that the reason why they're not playing in one of the big clubs here is because there's a lot of corruption. You have to pay.
You have to pay.
You know, and they say they come to me and say, "Madam, I need to pay, but I don't have money."
Mm.
And I'm like, "Well, neither do I."
Because you have to play Kotoko Hearts before you're paid well.
Are they paid well?
That's what we say. That you need to play for Hearts of Oko Asante Kotoko to get the opportunity, either to play abroad or in the national team or be paid well or anything.
Yeah.
Yeah, and we all can play Kotoko and Hearts of Oko.
Exactly. Exactly.
So there's a genuine rush. People just want to go out.
There's a rush, and people, like, I mean, he just mentioned that people would go anywhere.
Anywhere.
And I told you,
Bangladesh.
You know, people go anywhere just to leave.
Lithuania.
Just to leave the country. I mean, you get players going from Nigeria to Ghana, from Ghana to Nigeria to Gambia, you know.
Sudan.
To other parts of Africa.
They just want
know.
To go.
Yeah, I mean, there was at one point, I think everybody seemed to be going to Egypt,
yeah.
You know, from Ghana. Mm. A lot of Ghanaian players started going to Egypt. You know, they liked Ghanaian players, so a lot of Ghanaian players were going there. But again, he made another good point. You know, I mean, there's a lot of suffering. You know, people want money. So if they're going to offer you, if a club in India is going to offer you like $2,000, you know, dollars a month, and you're getting paid 50 Ghana cedis, In the
and there are players who are paid 50 CDs.
Yes,
in the league,
it's
in the Premier
poor,
League.
It's very poor.
We're playing a Premier League, a professional league, but people earn 50 CDs.
Oh yes,
wow.
Oh yes. When I've mentioned that in the UK, people actually don't believe me.
They don't believe.
Because when I say 50 Ghana CDs, they first of all think of $50 and think that's bad enough. But then when and then when I actually convert it, they're like, no way. You know, so it's really bad.
50 CDs is like what? £10. Yeah,
£10 or £15. Okay, okay, yeah. Something like that, yeah.
That's a lot of money, yeah.
And then as an agent, I'm meant to get 10% of that.
Yeah.
so that doesn't even do anything
so
for
you
my...
So you get 5 CDs.
There you go. You
we've
know?
Got some thoughts.
5 CDs, is that 10%?
Yeah, 5 CDs. 10% of 50 CDs.
Oh, 50, yeah, sorry. Yeah,
so it's 5 CDs.
Yeah.
Okay, Isaac Forsin says the competitiveness of the local league is not good enough to produce quality players who can make huge impact in Europe. That sounds to me like a good point.
Yes, that's a good point.
Okay, Samuel says, the get-rich-quick attitude is killing our talents. They leave at a time when they are not supposed to. But what is the time you're supposed to? That's the thing.
I keep asking.
That's what
I'm talking about this half-baked thing. When is the time you're supposed to?
When is the time?
If somebody wants you, it's demand and supply. Mm. You know, if there's a club out there.
But there's somebody engineering that demand. There's somebody somewhere engineering that demand for different reasons.
Well, when you say it's probably like agents, you know?
Agents.
Yeah, there are agents who are out there who will be looking at, like, you know, some work with certain clubs, and they might have been told, right, okay, you know, you'll get X amount of money if you go away and find us a left back, you know? So you'll go and find the left back, and, you know, and bring the left back to the club, usually scouting or, you know, a lot of clubs have scouts. A lot of clubs in Europe have scouts who work for them in Africa. You know, because certain clubs I'll speak to and they say, oh, yeah, we have a scout in Ghana, you know, or we have a scout in Nigeria. So they have people on the ground who will be looking out for
players. And the scout must eat, so you need to recommend the players.
There you
so
go,
you
scout must chop.
Frank Jesse says, the issue is not about maturity, rather the low quality of the local game. Mahatma, Otu, Fatal, Dauda, Emmanuel, Bafo, all left Ghana as mature players, but could just not make it, make the standards elsewhere. Comfort says, we lack the equipment and technical know-how to produce world-class players. The reason every Ghanaian player would have to spend not less than 5 years with a lower club before joining a top side. Are you able to restrict a player from joining another club anywhere in the world? Okay, we'll get into
exactly.
that. That's the work primarily of the agent. When we return, we'll look at the role of agents and the work a lot of the fake agents are doing, and Eby's campaign against the work of fake agents. We'll hear from her, read more of your thoughts, activate the phone lines for you to speak to us on the show, and then we'll wrap it up after this break. Okay, Sports File is live on Metro TV with me and Ernest Koranteng. My guest is Eby Emenike, who is a licensed football agent. She's here in the studio. We're talking the successful careers of footballers who live here to play abroad and what the missing links are. We've talked about this issue from the point of view of clubs who say they're often under pressure to sell the players, whether they are half-baked or quarter-baked or whatever. We've talked about the role of the players with Neo Date Lamte, a perfect example explaining what must go into the tactical and emotional readiness of a player who wants to go abroad and play. Let's talk about agency and the work of the agents now, the issue about fake agents and the capacity of agents to even get you good deals. I've been speaking to Oliver Arthur of Arthur Legacy. He's a licensed FIFA agent who has been speaking to us about this issue. Let's go listen to Oliver. When we return, we get reactions from Eby.
Looking for the talent, it's not difficult. We have talent in abundance. But the difficult aspect is whether the talent are developed enough to be able to make it in Europe. You know, you take the players in a Premier League and they've not been taught the system of the game, for example. You know, they've not been taught the tactics of the game. They have the skill, but the tactics is what gives out the problem. In my field, when I'm talking about taking players to Europe, I always look at three areas where there's possibility because of the development. First, we talk about players are able to move in Europe when they play in tournaments. The second one is in our league, for example, in Ghana here, if we're able to get single players who get to the high level of winning Goal King or winning best player of the league. These are players that especially European clubs come in for immediately to bigger clubs. Then the last aspect is where my interest most is to be able to take the young talent, 16, 17 years. Okay, that is where the European clubs want that kind of player to be able to develop them. My market mostly is in Italy. And Italy, when the player is 19, 20 years, they think that already he's old for them to be able to teach them new tricks. And in Ghana here, we don't have the facility, we don't have the pitches, so the players don't develop. We don't have the coaches with the right skill to teach the young players. So when you take them at that young age, 16, 17, that is when the European clubs are able to take this kind of players and then develop them too. So that is, to me, that is the easier way to be able to send players. They put them in school, try and get schools for them to put them in school, or the other system areas that I've talked about. Every young player wants to play in Europe. Every young player. So once people see that the demand is there, the zeal to go out is there, people cash in and then they try to make money out of it. Because I always tell players that, players call me and say, oh, I have an agent who wants to take me to Germany, but he said I will pay 2,000 euros. I told you no. Any agents that come in and says you are paying money, then it means straight away me, I tell them, I see them as fake agents. Because as an agent, I think that your job is to be able to convince the club in Europe that you are coming to take this boy, you buy his ticket, and as the agent, his visa processing, you do all those. The agent gets your money after the player, the club takes the player. So I don't see why you are taking money before you take the boy. So this is the little advice I can give the young players coming up. Anybody who comes in and says, pay money and I'll take you to Europe, I think those are the fake agents. There are a lot of them in the system, a lot. It's about what you do on the field. When you play well, everybody's coming for you. So what I want to advise those young, they shouldn't put in their head that they want to go to Europe. They should decide that I want to play football. I want to be the best in the system. Because most of the time, like the second example I gave you, second category, players that travel out there are players who excel. So if you are one of the players excelling, definitely you are going and you go to better clubs. Those who struggle to go there, struggle in Europe when they get there.
Okay, Oliver Arthur, let's go retrieve skills. speaking a lot of English on the TV. You've spoken to Oliver, and he's mentioning the things, the work of fake agents. It must be worrying you guys.
Yeah, oh yeah, it is very worrying. It is very worrying because, I mean, it's an avenue that I've kind of opened up and, you know, asked players to contact me if they've experienced fake agents or if they need advice.
Before you continue, there's a question from Ezekiel who says, how do I detect fake agents?
Well, Oliver's made a good point there. An agent is asking you for money. Straight away, that's a big
not
no.
Correct.
No.
Is there a reason you have this campaign? No. Yes. We have videos of the campaign. You've been touring some schools, soccer academies.
And we plan to roll it out to loads of others, yeah.
Tell me about it. Tell me a bit about it.
Okay, the campaign, it's called STAR.
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 S-T-A-R.
Yeah, I thought that was a good acronym because all footballers want to be stars.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. And it stands for Stop, Think, Ask, Then React.
Stop.
Think.
Think.
Ask.
Ask.
And then react.
And then react.
So basically, if an agent approaches you and has a deal for you, stop and think. There's a lot of questions you can, you know, there are a lot of things.
Why
you can
is he asking
about.
Me to pay money?
You know, well,
why, you,
well,
know, you, well, you ask yourself
all,
those questions.
Yeah, but first of all, you think about, you know, the deal that's being brought to you. If you're playing in a third division club in Africa, why are Chelsea or Man United coming for you? You know, I'm not saying that they can't.
It's not possible.
Yeah.
But I mean, you've got to do the analysis.
You've got to be harsh sometimes. You've got to really think about it.
Okay, so that's you on the TV. What are you doing? Let's listen to what she's saying.
Yeah, oh, that is me.
So okay, so you're teaching the kids. What are you telling them?
Well, at the moment, I'm just showing them a fake letter. You can't see it properly, but yeah, that was a fake letter from an agent who was inviting a player to LA Galaxy, and said it came from the club
in the United States.
Yeah. And that fake letter, when you actually look at it, you can't. These are two players who have actually been affected by fake agents. Yeah.
By the activities of fake agents.
But when you actually look at that letter, the letterhead is in place. It has a stamp. It's signed. Everything. So there's no way you'd be able to tell. So that young player that's asking, you know, or the young man that's asking, how can you detect fake agents? I mean, there are certain things you have to look out for, but don't just assume that because you've received a mandate or a letter that it's legit. Because it doesn't mean it's legit at all.
Receiving the letter doesn't make it legitimate.
It doesn't make it legit. I mean, you have to look at how you've been contacted. You know, a lot of players tell me, oh, the guy contacted me on Facebook. Now, you think of your club, AC Milan. Will they recruit on Facebook?
In fact, Galliani calls me every time before our games. Even Galliani doesn't send me Facebook message. He actually calls me, so I hear his voice.
I see.
Before we agree on the selection and everything. That was just by the way. My Mercado sends a message. He says, in the past, due to the high rate of age cheating, players left Ghana very mature, but now players don't age cheat like before. The problem of age cheating, how does it affect the agency job?
It doesn't really affect the agency job per se.
It doesn't.
Not the agency
so
job
the
as such.
The clubs abroad don't ask about this.
Well, I've had agents tell me that one of the big problems they have with African players is that they lie about their ages. So I mean that is something that even though everybody says it's an open secret and it's something people try not to talk about, there are a lot of agents and clubs that know about it these days. But I mean, I believe the problem is still there. You know,
the age cheating.
The problem is still there. Working on
it's
some
an
of
African
them,
problem. I hear it's a South American problem.
South American as well. I mean, one of the problems I have working with solidarity compensation at the moment is, I was telling you earlier on, the solidarity compensation, when a player is transferred to a new club, 5% of the transfer fee is taken and shared amongst the clubs that trained him between the ages of 12 and 23. Now, when the age cheating problem comes in, if a player is trained by one club from 12 to 16, and then he goes to a new club, and that club decide that they're going to turn him 12 again, that means that two clubs will have trained him for the same period. So when it comes to solidarity compensation,
then it becomes a problem. There are two or three clubs
coming through saying
claiming I trained this guy between this time and this time.
So that has been a problem.
Oh, so age cheating hasn't exactly gone away. Is there?
No, it's there. It's there.
Let's do some more thoughts. Priscilla sent us a message. She says, the strong desire by players to play outside will always cause them to make wrong moves. Godfred Asama says, our players must be paid well so they stay in the country to mature. Philip says, our clubs are eager to sell their players to make money without thinking of the players' welfare. I agree. Evan Sadiaba says, from Santa Maria, says, please ask her if she can also help me play, because I'm a footballer, but I do not have anybody to help me. I get these calls all the time. I'm really in support of the project she's handling, and being a victim of the fake agent, I am in support of this very much. I really love her courage. Okay. Thank you. Okay, so try and get in touch. You have the text line. So when we're done with the show, get in touch. Let's see what we can do together to drive this agenda of fake agents and their activities in the world of football, specifically what's happening in Ghana. Baba from Dakuman says, I want to be a FIFA agent in future. Please, how can I get FIFA license? Get to the Football Association. The route is very simple. I'm sure they'll help you out with that. Gordon says, please, kindly, he's sending this message from UPS. Kindly ask her if she can help my brother. Seriously, he plays excellent football, and how can I see her? You've got the contact to us, so you call us after the show. Bright from Volta says, in Volta, there's a lot of talent, but they do not have the opportunity. I'm a very passionate player myself, but I do not belong to any team. Okay, Lucas says, I'm a footballer and looking for a manager. Please, I want Madame to help me move forward. Bismarck, what qualification do you need to become a FIFA agent, and what are the steps involved there? Missing link is corruption and selfishness down here in Ghana soccer. We have the time to do maybe one or two phone calls. Call us on 0302-782-789 and be part of the conversation. We'll take about two or three phone calls, and we can wrap it up. We'll call it a wrap on Sports File tonight. So there are messages coming through.
Yeah.
People want to play football. I'm sure you get these all the time.
I get them all the time. And, you know, again, going back to what Oliver said, you know, there's a certain caliber of player that you're looking for, you know, because everybody believes that they can make it, you know. And I'll never try and crush anybody's dream.
Okay.
But at the end of the day, you know, there's the business aspect, and then there's kind of like, you know, the kind of
the emotional aspect.
Exactly.
You know, the feeling to want to help somebody.
You know,
I'll stop you in your tracks. Let's do William, who is calling us from Takrady. William, thank you for your time. Let's hear you.
Thank you for my brother for the discussion that you have the youth in the football industry. My name is William from Takrady, sports presenter. We just invited again.
Okay.
I was really enjoying the show. It's a very good education.
Okay.
And my brother, we want to carry on with the issue because a lot of guys are suffering with the issue. Every day, almost I see some 50 calls about players who wanted to travel.
Oh, they call you too? They call you all the time?
They want to take me to Vietnam and Thailand, those kind of things. Pay this money, pay that money. And I tell them, my brother, if you want to play football and travel, you are not supposed to spend your own money. They reach out at the club in Europe to do those kind of things. So the boys, they are in hurry. They want to travel. That's the main thing. So we need to educate them more.
Okay.
And it's our duty to do that. So thank you for the program.
Thank you, William, for your call. So STAR is a call in the right direction. What exactly are you doing? You're here mainly for STAR. What's happening? Tell me.
Yes. Well,
how well are you pushing this agenda?
We've been working on, I have some volunteers.
Okay.
You know, a couple of people who saw what I was doing, came forward, and they're interested in helping out. So I've had them, you know, just big, trying to put together an organization chart. I want to see the 10 regions you have, the regional associations, football associations, try and find out how many division, first division, second division, third division, Colts teams you have. And it's about going out like I did today to the schools, to the football schools, to the football clubs, and actually just trying to educate the players and their parents about some of these issues. There are certain simple things, like I was talking earlier on about Facebook. You know, that's one of the big signs. If you're contacted via Facebook, another big sign is if they want money and they're telling you they're going to get your visa. You need to get your visa in your home country. An agent that doesn't know anything about you, doesn't know your details, doesn't know your date of birth, cannot fill in your visa. Also, work permit issues. If you're playing in a, you're not playing for your national team, you're not going to get a work permit to play in the UK. You know, so these are things that, if players are educated, then they will kind of think, you know, when they're approached. I'm putting together an app. I've got an app being built. It's a mobile phone app. Yes.
It's all to educate the young players.
Yes, they can download it onto their phones, and, you know, whenever they are approached, they can quickly go on it.
Make reference to it. Let's do Timothy, who is my next caller. Hi, Timothy. Tim.
Yeah, please.
I have a brother whose career is in football career, but I want to see if the woman can help me in terms of some way or any way that she can do that, give us her whole contact so that
okay.
There's anything like that.
Tim, please call this number after the program so we talk. Yeah.
Yeah, please.
Thank you, Tim. Yeah. So you're doing this only in Ghana or you're doing it elsewhere?
No, you didn't get to see the logo. You don't have a picture of the actual star logo. At the moment I'm doing it in Ghana and in Nigeria.
In Ghana and Nigeria.
So if you had a
You can't leave out Nigeria, can you?
Not at all.
Uh-huh.
Not at all.
So Ghana and Nigeria.
Yes.
And how is it working? How is the campaign coming up?
It's only just started, really.
Okay.
It's only just started. So but I've had so much support. You know, I've had a lot of people that are really interested in getting involved, you know. I'm going to be going out to try and get sponsors, you know, like beverage sponsors. So when I organize these kind of events, like today, for instance, you know, we had snacks for the kids, we had refreshments for the kids. At the moment, it's self-funded. I'm paying for everything.
You have the cash to pay, so it's fine.
That's what everybody thinks. Mm. You know, so I'm looking for sponsors that can help with stuff like that. Mm. Also, educational institutions, for instance, you know, if educational institutions can give like sponsorships in terms of scholarships, mm. if a player has gone and had a bad ordeal, comes back and decides, I don't want to do football anymore, I want to study, then, you know, there's education institutions that can say, right, okay, we can take two players and we can, you know, find a way to find the best ones who are going to use it properly.
So you've come to do this. When are you returning to see how it progresses from here?
I don't have any solid plans, but,
okay.
You know, if I need to come in, I can come in.
Okay, let me do Josie, who is my last caller. Josie, thank you for your call. Let's hear you. Yeah.
Well done. My brother, I think this program should be repeated to the youth. It's a very nice show.
Thank you, Josie.
And if the players, they are watching and listening, then I think it will help more of us. So I'm pleading with you to repeat it again.
Okay.
So that they will learn something out from it.
Okay,
and
Josie.
The police and the radio must also pick it from here.
Mm.
To pitch it because the players, they are really suffering. On the foreign line. Thank you, my brother.
Thank you, Josie. Thank you for your call. Let me do just two quick messages. We'll take something small from you and we'll end it. Our Coast football is dying. I've been hearing this for a very long time. I love your program. Keep it up. There's a lot of prejudice in soccer and we've seen a lot of incidents recently. I understand that it's not a thing of the past. Government should support team management to run clubs because when honor comes, the government cannot be thrown out. With all the restrictions and agents in Ghana, this one, the final one says, the commitment is not there in our local league as compared to what happened previously. And the motivation levels are very low. Thank you for your messages. We've got to be going. So what are our expectations? STAR, the STAR project, the STAR campaign.
Mm-hmm.
How well do you expect it to do? What's the timeline? How big do you expect it to become?
Well, I'm hoping it would be quite big because, like I said, I've had a lot of players contact me. Some have lost from, you know, as little as $300 to $3,000, you know. So this is one of the things I'm hoping to stop. So I'm really wanting to blow it up. I've had journalists interview me in the UK regarding this, and they always say, Eby, we've done this before. We've run, you know, articles like this since 2001. But if you're doing it in the UK, and people are just reading it and putting their papers down, how is that solving
why
the problem?
Why do you not go to the market? Where
exactly.
Yeah.
This is the root. This is the root of the problem. So that's one of the reasons why I've decided to come in here and do
good.
It. So, I believe it's going to be big. I'm hoping to get more volunteers who I can train on doing certain things. Because I'm not going to be able to do all of that. You know,
and you
to everywhere.
Be here all the time.
And I won't be here all the time. If I can get people who can do that, we're going to have ambassadors and champions. The champions are going to be star champions, are going to go out there, and they're the ones who are going to spread the word.
And then the information.
Yes.
Eby, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
How do you say that in Yoruba?
I keep telling you I'm not Yoruba.
Okay.
Ibo.
Ibo.
Dalo.
Okay, so how do you say that?
Dalo. Dalo is like me.
Okay, merci beaucoup. I'm going to have your time. So you leave on Saturday.
I live back to Lagos.
Back to Lagos.
I still have some stuff to do.
All the best. Eby,
thank you very much.
He's a licensed football agent, my guest on Sports Fire tonight. My name is Ernest Koranteng. Thanks to the team. Just before I go, this quick one. Rita Dazi, you left Agri Memorial in the year 2008. Please get in touch. It is very, very important. Or if you know her, she lives in Dansuman. Please get in touch. It's very important. Good night.